Jonah chapter number 3, and all we're going to read is the first two verses. And it says, "And the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time, saying, Arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee." Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you again for your word. Lord, we are thankful not only for your grace, Lord, but we're thankful for Calvary. Lord, we're thankful for the blood, Lord, that you shed on the cross for us, Lord. As Brother Donald alluded to in his prayer, Lord, we have no, just lack the common understanding, Lord, of why you do what you did for us, Lord. We do thank you for it, though, Lord. We're thankful to be in your house tonight, Lord. I ask you to just help what you've laid upon my heart. Lord, help me convey it here to your people the way you gave it to me, Lord, that it can help us tonight, that each and every one of us can walk out of here tonight closer to you than we was when we came in. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. The first thing I'm going to look at by these first couple verses, I want to see who is speaking here. The Lord's speaking to Jonah. And the word of the Lord came into Jonah the second time. It's important on who we're listening to. You know, that goes without saying, but the one main person that we need to make sure always that we're listening to is, what does the Lord say? Not what somebody else says, not what man says, not even what, you know, you get great... You know, our pastor has alluded to this many times. You can find great commentaries, great things written in the Bible or on the Bible. And those things are great in their place, but the best thing that we need to listen to is what the Bible says. What does God say about certain things? You know, I started months ago, probably now, going in when we go to jail at the beginning of every service. I'll ask if anybody has any questions, Brother Donald. And this has been a couple months ago. One of the ladies asked, "Well, how do I know what religion to pick?" I was like, "Well, I can tell you what religion we might be, but what you need to worry about, what does the Bible say? Don't worry about what anybody else comes in here and says. Whatever they tell you is fine, but what does the Bible say about those things? What does God say about certain things?" That's where we need to turn our focus. Not what man says, not what anybody else professes to teach or whatever, but what does the Bible say about this? And that's why it's important, because of who was speaking to Jonah. God had told him to do these things. And that's why it says the word of the Lord came unto Jonah. Not only do we see the Lord speaking, but we see what he wants him to say, and we see the Lord's words. What does he tell him in verse number 2? "Arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee." Not what you think, not what you think Nineveh needs, not what you think those people need, not what you think about those people, but you need to preach the words that I give you. That's why, you know, I'm sure, for all the preachers in here, that's why you spend time studying. For me, myself, that's why you preach it to yourself 100 times, Brother Ron. You go through so many things, and there's so many things that you write down and you jot down, and you try to do certain things by memory, and you go over it time and time again for what God wants you to say. Not what I want to say. You know, for me personally, that's why you get more and more people in a service that may have preached for years or whatever it may be, Brother Ray. It's why I will tend to get more and more nervous. Because you don't want to say something, not to even slip up and say something wrong. Even by accident, you don't want to say anything that's wrong. You want to stick to what it is that God has told you. And that's why it's important when we go out and talk to others, and we'll get to that in a little bit, on using what God has given you. So we see the Lord speaking, we see the Lord's words and the preaching that he tells Jonah to go do, but we also see the lack of disobedience here. We know what Jonah did the first time. If you don't know the story of Jonah, we know that in chapter number 1, God told him this exact same thing. Go unto Nineveh and preach to him. And Jonah goes the complete opposite direction. But this time in verse number 3, we see that lack of disobedience. So Jonah arose and went unto Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. This time, he did exactly what God had told him to do. How many times and how many chances, and that's what we'll preach on in a little bit, do we think we deserve or we should be getting for what we do? How many times has God told us to do certain of something, whatever it may be, and for us to go the opposite direction? We might not completely get up like Jonah did and go catch a boat the complete opposite direction, but how often do we still not do what he told us to do? How many times will it take before we become obedient to the Lord? Amen. Which leads me to the whole, what goes on right here, is we see the long-suffering of God. We know in chapter number 2, we obviously know, you know, the end of 1, the end of chapter number 1, Jonah gets swallowed up by the great fish. And we know in chapter number 2, he spends that time and he compares it to being in hell. And he talks about everything that he goes through in the belly of that fish. And we know that the fish vomits him out. But we see the long suffering of God, that God still gave him another opportunity. And that's what I want to preach on with God's help tonight, is another opportunity. You think about, and where this all come from, is I don't remember somebody said it Wednesday night or what happened on Wednesday night, but if you remember back in revival, we had a certain election that took place on Tuesday night. And that Tuesday, the election, Brother Eddie, went the way we wanted it to go for the most part. We got what we wanted. Not only did we get what we wanted in the presidential race, we got what we wanted in the Senate race, we got what we wanted in the House race. The people that we supposedly think we want in office control everything right now. Wonderful, great. What are we going to do with that opportunity? As our pastor alluded to on Sunday night, Brother Donald Trump is not our Savior. Right. He is not going to change this country. Right. It's going to take Christians to change this country. Donald Trump is not going to come in and change Florence. Donald Trump is not going to come in and change Emmanuel Baptist Church. Donald Trump is not going to change the hearts of the people that are around here. It's going to be up to us to do those things. Right. Can I say we have another opportunity, number one, to get the gospel out. Right. What are you doing to get the gospel out? Not what the church does. What do you do to get the gospel out? Now, granted, you might not be able to, we've talked about this ad nauseum almost, but you might not be able to physically go out with us on Monday nights. Our pastor has mentioned many times, I've yet to have anybody that come and ask me anything about doing a different night or anything like that. If you physically can't go, can you pray? Can you stuff the bags? I'm so thankful for all of you that stuffed bags. By the time we got to the end of it this year, we had, I don't know how many bags are back there stuffed. I'm very thankful for all those things, but what are you doing? Not what your neighbor's doing, not what everybody else is doing. What are you doing to get the gospel out? See, if you followed anything about politics or anything about all this election and stuff like that that was going on, the other side that we didn't like had somebody at one of their rallies, so-called, I guess probably a week, maybe 2 weeks or something like that before the election, that somebody yelled out, I don't know if it was either Jesus is King or Jesus is Lord. And this was her response, Brother Brian, you're at the wrong rally. You want that small rally down the road. That is what we could have possibly had. If you go back, and I didn't even think about this until I heard somebody say it about a week or so ago, go back and listen to any of her stuff and try to hear any mention of God anywhere, Brother Ron. Right. Good or bad. Look, we can all agree that Christmas can be just as pagan as it can be, but it is that time that people take notice of Jesus' birth. Right. So good or bad, you didn't hear them mention God in anything. They wanted nothing to do with God. So God has now allowed somebody to win the election, has allowed somebody to be put in place that, you know what, maybe we can still meet for the next 4 years, however long it be. So what are you going to do to get the gospel out? Yep. What are you going to do to get, like I've alluded to, one of the, if you want to call it the downsides or whatever it may be, but one of the things about being out when you go to jail and you come back right around Sunday school time or right after Sunday school starts, you realize how many people could care less about church. You go look at that antique show once it starts up again in the spring out there that one Sunday a month, that fairgrounds is packed. Right, yeah. I remember one of the first years that I stopped and we would do chicken and have the fellowship on Sunday mornings. I would stop at Kroger and get chicken. You walk into Kroger and it's packed on a Sunday morning. Like, what in the world? Because we get in our own little bubble. We get in our own little cocoons and you don't realize how many people out there just don't care about what's going on. So what are you doing to get the gospel out? What are you doing to see that people at least have something placed in front of them? You know, I want to talk to Pastor. I would really like to challenge us. We have those little thank you sincerely, and I'd hate to see him get a bunch of them back. But how many gospel tracts do you pass out at the table? How many do you pass out through drive-thru? And I will be the first one to admit it takes an effort to remember to do that when it's not something you always do. We have tried to start doing that. And how many times you go in and you forget? Or how many times I now have them in the door of my car and you go through drive-thru and you still forget? You know, how many times you forget to give those things out? But still, at least make the attempt. Have them with you so that you make sure that when you remember, you can pass them out. Amen. That might be what it takes. You don't know what that person, I have yet, if any times I've ever handed them out, knock on wood, and it could happen tomorrow, I've yet to have anybody say, no, I don't want that. I've never had anybody tell me they don't want it. They'll take it, they might look at it, they might go in and throw it away. But at least the effort was there. Right. What are you doing to get the gospel out? We have another opportunity to do that, because if the other side had got in, We have no idea what may have taken place. Not only we have another opportunity to get the gospel out. I thought about this today, actually. We have another opportunity to gain neighbors in heaven. You think, Brother Josh, isn't that the same thing? No, not really. In Acts chapter number 8, verses 30 and 31, we know that this Ethiopian eunuch was traveling. He was reading, and Philip is instructed to go meet him. And he gets down to verse number 30, and it says, "And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Esaias, and said, Understandest thou what thou readest? And he said, How can I, except some man shall guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him." And we know the rest of the story. Philip goes and talks to him and tells him what it takes to be saved and what it takes to be baptized. And they see water a little bit later. And Philip goes down. He says he believes. And Philip baptizes him and all these things. When was the last time you told somebody about Christ? Now, see, there's a difference in sharing. We can pass out gospel tracts, Brother Daniel. But when was the last time you then explained that to somebody? When was the last time you truly asked somebody, do you understand what this means? Do you know what, and I love this, talking to Brother, I don't know how many times we'll get these stories about, Brother Phil will tell us that Sunday, before we go into jail, we'll stand out back and we'll pray, usually, or pray before we go in. And how many times Brother Phil will tell us a story, hey, I ran into somebody yesterday over at Home Depot or wherever it may be, and we just started talking about God. And almost without fail, Brother Phil will eventually get to that point. He goes, can you go back to that time you know you trusted Christ as your Savior? Not just telling him that Jesus died for him, not just telling him that Jesus loved him. Say, do you know what it means to be saved? I didn't ask you if you got baptized. I didn't ask you if you're a member of a church. Can you go back to that time where you trusted him? When was the last time you shared that with somebody? When was the last time you truly got down where the rubber meets the road with somebody and asked them, do you know what it means to be saved? Do you know what it truly means to be able to go to heaven? Not do you know who Jesus is, not have you been baptized, as we alluded to, or go to church. I'm asking, do you know what it means to have that personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Because a lot of times, we have no idea. A lot of times, we get scared. Well, what if they ask me a question? Well, what if they do? I tell them, and I ask them at the jail if anybody has any questions. If I know the answer, I'll do my best to answer. If I don't, I'll tell you I don't know, and we'll try to figure it out. I don't know everything. Nowhere close do I know everything. As we our pastor said it, I've said it, all these preachers probably said it, just tell them what God's done for you. Just tell them what it was like when you met the Lord. Share that experience with them. Tell them that it's not about being baptized. It's not about going to church. It's not about all those things. It's about truly trusting and putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. We have another opportunity to gain neighbors in heaven. We have another opportunity to tell people. And this is really kind of, I'm trying to think of the right word to use. I know I've gotten too many drinks, Miss Tina, but I'm nervous. One of the things that I've noticed, different posts and things like that about, is everybody wanting to down religion in the fact of talking about, there was something I seen the other day, somebody shared a post about kids leaving religion, and they're not leaving religion, and said Brother Ron, because they don't like the Bible. It's because you told them the Bible and they read the words of Jesus and they believe them. Like, no, they're trying to say, what I took as an implication was, they're trying to say like that Christians don't love each other or don't love people or whatever. No, I do. I just don't like your sin. Amen. I don't like the stuff that the Bible calls an abomination. And see, that's why there's so many people out there that don't know what it's all about. They look at religion as a lot of the cult things that are going on. You can call it Catholicism or whatever you want. It's no more than a cult on what it is. And they look at those things and they see those things and they don't understand what it's like to have that true relationship. They think it's about going to church and giving money or doing this or doing that. When was the last time we truly explained to them the gospel? It's one thing if all you got time to do is hand them a tract going through drive-thru. That is wonderful. Hand them that tract and go on about your day. But if you have a chance to have that conversation with people, a neighbor, a coworker, whatever it may be, you tell them, can you go back to that time and place? Because there's a lot of people out there that don't understand. As I alluded to in the jail, as the lady asked that question, what religion do I choose? Well, you don't choose a religion, choose the Bible. But that's all they know. Though, unfortunately, we can't control who goes in there. So they have other people you can see where they sign in different days of the week that other organizations come in there and teach them who knows what. They need to know what the Bible says. What does the Bible say? And that's exactly what that Ethiopian eunuch needed. He needed to know exactly what it was. He didn't understand what he was reading. They might read those tracts and understand. So you're trying to tell, you know, Brother Donald alluded to it in his prayer. You're trying to tell me this person died for me, Brother Phil? Why would he do something like that? Well, explain it to him, because he loves us. In spite of us, he loves us. We have another opportunity to get the gospel out, another opportunity to gain neighbors in heaven. And this right here is where I'm going to lose most of you. We have another opportunity to give. 2 Corinthians chapter number 9 and verse number 7. Every man, according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Can I say this? Giving cheerfully goes beyond giving the bare minimum. Giving cheerfully goes beyond, because anybody can, I don't want to say anybody, because I understand, you know, Pastor, he shared the story this past Sunday about giving his last check, and that was his tithes, and but it goes beyond that. We was talking in, and I'll use this, I added this after we had the discussion last night, and, you know, we was talking last night in the Bible Institute, and we got to John, and we're in John, and we was talking about the alabaster box. And we've all heard that alabaster box was worth, you know, about a year's wages at that point in time. So a year's wages at this point in time would be about $50,000. I'm not asking you to give $50,000, but when was the last time, or have you ever, given to God an amount that you actually had to think about before you threw it in the plate? That you actually had to sit down and think, should I do this? God's touched my heart to give this amount of money, whatever it may be. It might be $20, but that $20 might really stretch you that week. Whatever it may be. Because it's easy when we are wonderful, God-fearing, Bible-believing Christians, we don't give it a second thought to write that tithe check out. But when do we ever give a thought to, you know what, I'm just going to give an extra $500 this week. I'm just going to give an extra $100 this week. I'm just going to give. I don't really know that I can afford it. I don't really know that this is that I'm. But you know what? I just believe that this is. We just need this for the building fund. We just need this for the kids. We just need this for whatever. I'm just going to give it, whatever it may be, whatever God may touch your heart about. When was the last time, or have you ever done that? You hear about so many of these small churches at times and the amount of money they give. Why? Because they just love God and just want to give. Not only about our money. I'll get off money. All right, now everybody can cheer up a little bit. Okay, maybe just a little. I'm not going to get on your money no more. What about your time? When was the last time that, and look, he might not want help. I'm sure he would probably take it. When was the last time, instead of sitting down to watch a ball game, or instead of sitting down and going and playing golf, or instead of the next time going out yard sailing or whatever, you come and ask Brother Ray, hey, do you need any help mowing this week? Yeah, I got things to do around the house, but I'm just going to go help you mow. Hey, whoever finds out, you know, whoever's decorating the church this week, or whoever's doing the flowers out there, don't go ask Miss Tammy. She'll get mad at me telling people to come ask. But when was the last time you gave any extra time to the things of God? When was the last time you made sure you went out of your way? Look, I know I can go home tonight and I can watch my TV shows, or I can do this or do that, but you know what? I'm just going to spend a little extra time in the book today. I understand I got up this morning, I spent an hour and a half studying. It was wonderful. Me and God had a great time. You know what? I just want to spend more time studying tonight. My TV show will just have to wait. My shopping will just have to wait. Whatever it may be, it'll just have to wait. When was the last time we truly gave that time out of necessity, out of just wanting to give back to God? We have another opportunity to give it. Because we don't know when that time may be up. And we'll get to all that in a little bit. Not only do we have another opportunity to give of our time and our token, so to speak, and our talents, but you now have another opportunity to possibly to give some things up. What's keeping you from where you need to be with God? Amen. What's keeping you from investing everything that you can of yourself into God? Because it is very easy to allow things to get in the way.
Sure.
Being transparent as possible.
Yep.
Brother Phil, when I went part-time back in April, 99.99% of that was to spend more time studying and more time invested into the church and the things of God.
Amen.
I'm nowhere close to what I wanted to be. Nowhere close to putting that amount of time in that I wanted to. I have more, Brother Ron, but still not anywhere close to what I have. But I also look at that time and think, how did we ever do everything that we did when I was working full time, Brother Donald? It's like, how in the world can we be so busy all of a sudden? See, it's very easy to allow things of this world, nothing bad, not being wrapped up in something wicked or anything like that, but it's very easy to allow the things of this world to take you away from the things of God. So maybe we've been given another opportunity now just to give some things up. Just to say, you know what, I need to be sold out the way God wants me to be sold out. Whatever that may entail. I'm not telling you got to go full-time in a ministry or do it. Just whatever it may entail, of whatever it takes for you to be sold out the way God wants you to be sold out.
Amen.
Not only do we have another opportunity to get the gospel out, gain neighbors in heaven, to give, but can I say this kind of lastly? There's a few more things, so don't get too excited. Maybe we have another opportunity to show a little bit of gratitude.
Yeah.
Amen.
How many times in 2016 did we hear this phrase? We've been given a space of grace.
Right?
Right? How thankful were we for the church? I'm not telling you, don't misunderstand me, I am not telling you that this is why things happen. I don't know why things happen. They happen because God wanted them to happen. But maybe we weren't thankful as church as we should have been, and that's why all of a sudden things started to get closed down. Maybe that's why everything started to come way to try to get Christians to wake up. Because you can see there's a whole lot of churches we hear about in the South never recovered. Because they seen exactly what God meant to them, is what I would say. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. I believe wholeheartedly if government came in and shut the church down and you chose after that not to go back, you showed exactly what God means to you. There ain't no other way around it. I don't see. Maybe we weren't as thankful for that time that we needed to be, and God sent something to wake us up. By no stretch of the imagination, once again, am I trying to say, compare Jonah spent that time in the belly of the fish that he compared to hell. And no stretch of imagination am I trying to say that was hell the last 4 years, but it might be as close to it as we'll ever get here on the earth.
Right.
This has been crazy.
Yeah.
Are we a little more thankful now? Or we just get back into the same ho-hum? Hey, now we get, hey, we got Trump in the presidency now, and amen, and he's going to do this, and look at the stock market already going up, and look at gas coming down, and groceries will start coming down, and everything's going to be good, and everything's right in the world, and we're just going to go right on. What's that got to do with the things of God?
Right.
What's that got to do with being here at church? What that's got to do with furthering the gospel?
Amen.
Maybe he's given us a chance to show a little gratitude for what we do have. Look, I've said this many times. I don't know why I say it. I don't know why God continues to put it on my heart. I think if we're just not careful, we have great, great, great men of God that used to come here and stand behind this pulpit that had great churches, and look where they are now.
Yeah. Yeah.
For whatever reason, I'm afraid we have in our head that it can't happen here. Really? Why do we think it can't? We really think we're that much better than everybody? That's a scary thought if we think we're above what anything else could happen.
Right.
We have a wonderful, wonderful pastor. We have a wonderful, wonderful church. And I would be willing to bet some of those churches would stand and would have said the same exact thing.
Right.
And look where they are now.
Right.
We have no idea what may happen. We have no idea what God could send our way. Because Pastor alluded to it Sunday, we might know who's in the White House, but we also know who's in Frankfurt.
Yep. Right.
We have another opportunity, possibly, to show gratitude. So what are we going to do with this opportunity? Can I say the first thing that Jonah did, Jonah, as we know, Jonah in chapter number 1, God told Jonah to go into Nineveh, preach unto that city. He didn't want to go. He went the opposite direction. So again, he tells him in chapter number 3, and the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time, saying, and we read the verse, and he sees, so what did the first thing he do? He put things into action. So Jonah arose and went into Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. What kind of action are we going to do? What kind of action are we going to take place to use the most of this opportunity we've been given? You look at Matthew chapter number 28. We you know, we talked about getting the gospel out and sharing the gospel with people and gaining people in heaven. Matthew chapter number 28 does not exclude anybody. There's nobody that I can see in Matthew 28 where it says, "Go you therefore." Does it say, unless whatever, your name starts with an A. Well, there you go, Brother Adrian, you don't have to go. I just come up with an A, the first letter, so Brother Adrian, not. No, it doesn't say that anywhere. It tells us all to go. It tells us all to do. Nowhere can I find in the Bible when it gives us certain instructions to do certain things unless you're this or unless you're that. So we must take action. We must get up and do something. It's not about coming in, and action is not coming and sitting in church on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, and going on about our day and think we've done something. I wonder, just a thought, that this, you know, we sang the song. What was the first song you sang, Brother Clint? I've gone blank now. Great is thy faithfulness. What if God was as faithful to us as we are to him? I was thinking that when we were singing that song. What if he was as faithful to us as we are to him? Amen. What if his actions toward us matched our actions towards him? What if he said, okay, that's fine. If you want to show up to my house on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and that's all the time you want to spend with me, that's all the time I'll spend with you. Good luck trying to survive this world.
Amen.
It takes action. Jonah acted. He immediately went out. Not only does it take actions, it takes an announcement. In verse number 4, and Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey, and he cried and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. I'm not telling you to go out there with a megaphone and tell everybody that the Lord's about to return and they're going to die and go to hell if they don't get saved. It might do us good some little bit, but I'm not telling you to do that. But just, are we going to tell people?
Right.
I thought about this. When you get to work on Monday, or maybe kids, you get to school on Monday, what's the first thing you talk about? Hey, did y'all see that game yesterday? Can you believe that throw that Burrow made? Or can you believe this? Or can you believe that? Or do you walk in, let me tell you about church service we had yesterday. Let me tell you how God showed up. It might be something as simple as that. Instead of worrying about automatically things of the world, what if we just talked about what happened at church? What if we just shared what God did? Let me tell you how God showed up. God showed up so big, our preacher didn't even preach yesterday. God just showed up in a mighty way, and he saved people at the jail and saved people there. Brother Phil started running. It was just wonderful. Make them say, who's Brother Phil? Oh, let me tell you about Brother Phil. If any of the rest of you want to run, we'll talk about you too. But can I say, it might take an announcement. It might take us trying to share a little bit. Not only does it take actions, not only will it take an announcement, but this is something that I believe that God gave me this, and I really thought about this a whole lot. We have the little track of what we normally put in, what we normally would pass out, and unless we run out of them or go through a whole bunch. And it's a whole track about 18 inches. The difference between your head to your heart. And how many people will miss heaven because they have him in their head, but not in their heart. And see, and that's where I think our trouble lies too often. We believe the Bible. We believe what the Bible says. So we believe that if we believe the Bible and believe what it says, that the Lord's return could happen at any minute. We believe that in our head. Do we believe it in our heart? I believe it's going to take us to acknowledge in our hearts how close we truly are. Based on everything, Brother Eddie's got the track right there. If we have to acknowledge in our hearts that if the Bible's true, there's nothing else has to take place for Jesus to come back. It could happen at any point in time. Do we truly believe that in our hearts? Now, I don't want to ask you if you believe it, because I believe we all believe it in our mind. I think in our minds, all of us believe that we believe the Bible, but do we truly believe it wholeheartedly? Because if we did, I think we'd live different. If we did, I think we would act different. If we did, I think we would have come into church tonight a little bit different. I think we'd have come in, even if it was just come in, hey, Sister Lisa talked about she's got an 85-year-old aunt just went through surgery, we don't know if she's saved or not. We'd have come in burdened by that. We'd have come in burdened by knowing that we have ladies that'll come in and men that might come in with their spouses that don't come with them, don't know if they're saved, that they need salvation. We'd have come in burdened to see them get saved. But instead, we just walked in for a normal service. How much do we truly believe in our heart that Jesus can come back anytime? I believe every one of us believe it in our mind. But we have to believe it in our heart. Because until we believe that in our heart, we're not going to take it serious. We're going to go through the motions. And going through the motions got us where we got back in 2020, and I would even say the last 4 years.
Amen.
By all accounts, we've been given another opportunity. That's what we talk about. Boy, everything went the way we wanted to. Great. That is wonderful. I'm not downplaying it by no stretch of the imagination. But what has gotten in there, I believe, will afford us the opportunity to be able to preach. Will afford us the opportunity to be able to try to get the gospel out, as opposed to what the other side is going to be. What are we going to do with it? What are we going to do with this opportunity we've been given? What are we going to do with this opportunity that God has allowed us to have, as we heard it so much back in 2016, maybe again, He's given us a space of grace? Are we going to take it and use it to our advantage? Or are we just going to take advantage of it and say, "Hey, we're good. I can just kick back now and let somebody else take care of everything. Let Pastor worry about it. Let somebody else worry about it." What are you going to do with the other opportunity? Jonah made sure that he did everything he could to go and preach the gospel. We know what happened in chapter number 4. I understand all those kind of things later on. But at this point in time, he realized, "I failed God before. I'm not going to now." Did we fail God when He gave us that opportunity before? What are we going to do with it now? Let's all stand and ask Brother Clint to come get a song of invitation. What are you going to do with the opportunity God's presented us with? What is Emmanuel Baptist Church going to be known as? If Jesus don't come back in the next 4 years, if Jesus don't come back by 2028, what will Emmanuel Baptist Church be known as? Will we be known as some of the other churches that have just went by the wayside? Or will we be known, that's where revival broke out, that's where the city of Florence was changed, that's where the state was changed, that's where the whole country got turned upside down, because that small church on top of the hill had people that just wanted to see God do something? Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank You, Lord. Thank You for Your Word. Lord, thank You for these people in the Bible that show us, Lord, exactly what they did with their opportunities. Lord, we You just laid Jonah on our heart. Lord, we could have picked anybody out of the Bible and the opportunities that You gave them in order to do something, Lord, the second time, third time, fourth time around even, maybe. Lord, we just ask You to just deal with hearts during this invitation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks to listeners like you, IBC has had over 100,000 views on our YouTube channel. If you haven't already, subscribe today. And as always, thanks for listening.